Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. There we go. Yeah, we got you. We got you out there. Thank you for being here. Welcome to Glenstone Baptist Church. There are people watching online, either live now or watching later. And thank you for joining us that way as well. If you are here and you're a guest today, I want to say right now, welcome to you. I hope somebody's shaking your hand or giving you even a hug, if you're okay with that. And welcomed you in the building today. Thank you for being here present with us in this service. If you're a guest and would like to leave us some information, we'd love to have that. In the back of the pew in front of you should be a card, a long card. Fill that out for us and drop it off either in the offering or on the way out the door. Pastor Ron will be here and give that to him. But thank you for coming, joining us today. If you're visiting, we pray that you will be blessed through the presentation that we have for you today. We're going to give you a chance to start and worship with us here. And there will also be a time during the program we'll turn and ask you to sing with us a couple of hymns as part of the Easter presentation. But we're going to start with one we're all going to sing together. Let's sing Victory in Jesus. Stand with me as we sing a couple of verses of this one here. Here we go.
I heard an old, old story.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus, for what he did. Amen.
Please pray with me. Father God, thank you for bringing us out here today. We thank you for the choir, for Doug, for putting in the work for this musical that they're bringing this morning. We pray that you give us open hearts to give back part of what you bless us with during this time of offering. Be with us today as we leave this place. Bless all those that couldn't make it out today. And use them to pray. Amen.
Amen.
Turn your attention, if you will, to your bulletin. I hope you picked up one. If you didn't, you may even want to slip out. There's a few by the door over here. In the bulletin today, we have an insert, and it has the words to the main solos. There are several other smaller solos, but the three longer solos in our musical presentation today, the words are there because they won't be on the screen. But the rest of the words for the presentation will be on the screens as part of the visual experience we'll have today. Just wanted you to note that. And then in your bulletin, you'll see the names of the people who will be part of our presentation today, the soloists, our narrator, and so forth. Thank you again for joining us today. Let's worship the Lord as we think about his resurrection. Thank you. We're going to ask you to join us here now. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Join us as we sing, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
It's Easter, and Jesus has risen. All that the cross was supposed to accomplish has been completed, and we can rejoice as children of the resurrection, as believers who have been given purpose and power in knowing the living, risen Christ. We've all imagined at one time or another what it must have been like to walk with Jesus, to see him in the temple, to listen to him speak of a kingdom unlike any other, to watch him perform miracles, and oh, the miracles, to taste the bread and the fish, to see the expression on the face of a girl no longer afflicted, or to feel the excitement and wonder of a deaf man hearing for the first time. That's why Jesus' ride into Jerusalem was so joyous. Here was a man who had been met with great controversy by many around him, from religious leaders to political figures, and even those who knew him personally. How could this man call himself the Son of God? But as he rode through the city, the palm branches were waving and the crowd was joyous and triumphant. Surely this man was who he said he was. Standing beneath the cross of Calvary, those who knew him best and loved him most stood horrified among the crowd that cried for his death. They had heard him speak of such things. They had sat with him and listened as he told of the betrayal that was to come. I'm sure it didn't make it any easier to watch him suffer. This man they had called friend, Lord, and son. It's hard to conceive how Mary Magdalene, John, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, must have felt. But I'm sure their hearts were breaking. I'm sure they wished he would have called the angels to his rescue. But he didn't. And all they could do was stand and watch and pray. Three words, I love you, said in oh so many ways, but never quite as poignantly as when spoken with the sound of hammer and nails. Oh, the love.
I left my home, I came so far. There was to where you are, the bitter tears, the long ache, the many ways a heart can break. And you are the center of it all. To free you from the prisons of the fall. There was no hill too steep for me to climb. You looked too long and hard to make you mine. I gave all I had to give, and it was worth the cost to say I love you. From an old rugged cross, I took you there. I bore your shame, and now we do it all again. My open arms reach out in grace to pull you in love's embrace. It's been spoken in a thousand different ways, and across it more than words could ever say. There was no hill to steep for me to climb, no road too long and hard to make you mine. I gave all I had to give, it was worth the cost to say I love you from an can you hear the echoes from the deep? I love you then, child, I love you still. There was no hill to see for me to climb. No road too long and hard to make you mine. I did all I had to do, and it was worth the cost to say I love you, I love you. From an old rugged cross.
Love me, loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life, what more could he give? Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life, what more could he and
But the love Jesus displayed on the cross and the death he died there isn't the end of the story. While the mourners were still mourning and his loved ones were still trying to adjust to life without him, while the skeptics were cheering and the naysayers were celebrating, something was happening. His loved ones must have remembered what he had said. This is not the end. But who could believe such a thing? But somewhere in the night, the Lamb of the Cross became the Lord of an empty tomb. What would his friends say? What would they believe? To see the scars in his hands, to feel the wounds in his side, to see him living and breathing and walking among them. Mary saw him on the road, and she did not recognize him. Maybe because she wasn't looking for a living Lord. But when she heard him speak, she knew. All that he had said was true. Jesus was dead, but now he is alive. Just as surely as we celebrate the power of the resurrection, we also reflect on the cross and we share in the suffering. When Jesus died, he died for my sins and for your sins. His wounds were my wounds, and his pain was my pain. Oh, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering.
heard you faintly say. Still in my heart I feel so guilty. I know the truth is the debt was mine to pay. How could it be right that it happened this way? Fallen and sinful life I was leaving. Why is your body torn and bleeding?
And now, centuries later, we live because he lives. We are no longer doomed to the tomb of our sins and the grave of our failures. He lives. We no longer wear the prison clothes of our humanity because with his resurrection, he took the keys to our destiny and he holds them out to us, offering us life everlasting. He lives. Every prodigal child has a home. Every disease-ridden saint has the hope of healing. Every lonely outcast can find redemption because Jesus died and was laid in a tomb. And that tomb is empty now.
Cannot see tomorrow through these tears of yesterday, and I'm weak from climbing mountains that are standing in my way. When my heart is overshadowed by the grief that weighs me down, I remember the tomb is empty now. My joy turns into sorrow, and my victory to loss. If I somehow lose my focus, and I can't see past the cross, let my tearful eyes be lifted to that resurrected crown. Oh, hallelujah, the tomb is empty now.
Bread and fear that grip my heart. the cross. Have you ever stopped to think about it? The simplicity of the cross, and yet at the same time, the profoundness of the cross. I mean, when you stop and you begin to think about it, we could have probably done better for getting a symbol for Christianity, right? Or could we have? I mean, you think of the Jewish faith, and they have what's called the Star of David. You think of the Islam faith, and it is a crescent moon. Even the Buddhist faith has a beautiful lily. And we have a cross, the symbol of torture, of pain, of agony. And yet the reality is this. It best represents who we are. See, the bottom line is it's a very simple thing with two beams that intersect in the middle. One goes horizontal and one goes vertical. And yet they come together and they meet. I stop and I begin to think about the one reaching from the earth to heaven. As far as the eye can see, it represents the holiness of God. And the other stretches like God's arms towards us in that God loved us. The height of God's love we will never see. The width of God's love we will never experience. God is love. But there's that intersection. There's that place where God's love and God's holiness comes together. And it is in that intersection that makes the difference. I mean, think with me, if you will, for a second. God's throne in heaven. God is seated upon that throne with the angels all around him. And you and I are on the earth with no way for us to be able to get to where God wants us to be. And yet at that intersection hung the body of Christ, our Savior. And the only way that we can ever get to God is according to the Word of God. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And no man, no woman, no boy, no girl can ever get to where God wants us to be in his holiness without the death of Jesus. The Bible says without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. So Christ stands at that meeting place. Christ stands at that intersection. And what you and I do with Jesus determines the address where we will spend eternity.
That's right.
We may not like it, but there is a place called heaven, and it is real, and there is a place called hell, and it is real. And today we have tried to explain it away, and yet the reality is, as God says, there is a heaven and there is a hell, and there is one way to heaven, and it's not by coming to church and being bored by your pastor, but it's by the death of Jesus Christ. But it didn't stop there. No, without the empty tomb, there is no hope. Today you've heard a presentation, but it's more than just a presentation. You can go anywhere and hear a presentation. You can pay hundreds and even thousands of dollars to go and to be entertained, but this is not about entertainment. This is about that intersection. This is about your eternity. This is about God's love. And God today is asking for you and I to make a choice where we will spend eternity, or will we accept Christ or not. Can I tell you something? I was writing my notes down, and the thought hit me. God's already made that choice. God made that choice when he said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. You see, the truth is God made his choice about you. God loves you. God was willing to die for you. And now he says to you this morning, what will you do with Jesus? What will you do with your life? God's love, we would never be able to understand it, the height of it, the width of it. But we know this, there on the cross, between heaven and hell, between man and God, hung his son, Jesus. Because God loves you. And God invites you to do several things. Number one, the Bible says we must acknowledge that we've sinned, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And number two, we have to ask Jesus Christ to forgive us of our sin and become the Savior of our life. And if we do that, the Bible says that we will experience everlasting life, not starting when we die, but starting as we live.
Amen.
And so this morning, God invites you to make a decision. We're going to give an invitation this morning. We're going to invite you to come. The song we're going to choose is basically the Savior is waiting, and he has been waiting for some of you for years. Your parents have prayed for you. Your spouse has prayed for you. Your friends have prayed for you. But Jesus has been waiting. And this morning, he invites you to come and to say, I give my life to Christ. I accept him as my Savior and my Lord. I'll be here at the front to meet you if you'd like to come and make that decision to give your life to Christ. As we sing a verse of our invitation, the Savior is waiting. Would you stand with
me? The Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why don't you let me come in? There's nothing in this world to keep you apart. What is your answer to me?
One more verse, would you come as we sing?
If you will take one step for the Savior, my friend, you will find his arms open wide.
Second. The cross, think about it. We see it everywhere. You see it in the church, on the pews, in the Bible. Even as you look on the stained glass behind us, there's the cross. You see it at grave sites. You see it even on jewelry that many of you ladies have worn, and now guys wear it too, the symbol of the cross. My prayer is today that if you don't know Christ as your Savior, that every time you see that cross, that you remember this is God's attempt to bring you to himself, to experience his holiness and his love, and someday to spend eternity with him. But that intersection is up to you. What you do with Jesus will determine where you will spend eternity. God bless you. Choir, thank you for what you've done today. I mean that from the depths of my heart. We appreciate it. We know a lot of work goes into a presentation, leading us in time of worship. And from your pastor's heart, I say thank you for what you do. Solos were great today. They really were. Are we going to all start wearing this? I'm just curious if this is the new dress code here. There are several announcements, and can I do this before you conclude so we can finish the announcements and then we can move on from there and end? I like to think on an upbeat. Am I right? We ought to walk out of here every Sunday ready to take on the world. Amen? And that's the way it ought to be. So thank you so much. Oh, we are collecting water bottles. We're having a big day, and you'll be hearing more about it after Easter. We've waited till get through the Easter season. We are doing a hook, line, and family day here on the parking lot. Actually going to have live rainbow trout that are going to be delivered, and we're going to let kids fish for them. Amen. So if you have children, make sure they come. It's going to be a great day. Some great prizes. We need water bottles because we're going to have crafts, we're going to have food, and we're going to have everything on that day. So we need you to bring water bottles. You know, those small ones that you get and you throw away. Don't throw them away. Don't recycle them, okay? Just bring them. And we have a thing down. It's one of the crafts that we'll be doing, and so we want to encourage you to go ahead and bring that. We also have election coming up in just a week or so, and we need people to work the election. So we call it security, but actually it's welcoming. If something breaks out here, you just leave. Okay, we don't want you breaking the fight up, and we don't want you in it, okay? But you just leave. But what we need you to do is to be here to welcome the people. Our first response as a church, when we get them through that door, is so vital to the ministry of this church. And so if you have that available on the April the 2nd, if you would come, and like I said, there's a sign-up sheet downstairs. We are still collecting for the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. Our goal is $3,500. We prayed about that. We believe that's the right thing to do. And now we're asking you to pray about what you're going to give towards the Annie Armstrong. Did I see Lottie Moon?
No.
Okay, I said Annie Armstrong. Okay, we're good. And so we want to encourage you to do that. On Friday night, we are having a Good Friday service, and you won't want to miss it, and I really do mean that. We encourage you to come, bring your family. We do our evening services like that shorter than normal services, so you don't have to worry that you're going to be forever, but we're going to start at 7 o'clock, and so we want to encourage you to come and to be a part of that on Friday night. It's going to be a time that we remember the price that Christ paid for us, and so we want to encourage you to come and to be a part of that also. And then Sunday morning, is Easter. Can you believe it's Easter? I think it was funny because a lot of people won't give in to Christ, but they'll celebrate the next day, which is April Fool's Day. Very appropriate. Okay? Amen? Am I right? And so we want to encourage you to invite them so April Fool's Day will not be on them. We want to encourage you to invite them to come and be a part of our Easter service. We're actually going to have breakfast beginning at 8 o'clock in the morning. You don't have to be here at 8 o'clock. You can come at 8:30 if you want. But we will have breakfast that morning, and we're asking you to bring, if I understand it correctly, finger foods that people can grab and go, meaning donuts and waffle sticks and carrots and what. Never mind, don't bring the carrots, okay? That's for the Easter bunny, okay? And so we want to encourage you to do that. Let me, if I can, do something before I turn it back over to Doug. Tomorrow, Linda, I didn't say that right, did I? Lisa, I'm sorry. I knew your name. Lisa Ellis is having surgery tomorrow, and we're going to have a word of prayer for Lisa in just a second. And then, Di, your husband called me this morning as he was driving down the road heading to a golf tournament. So I hope he wins big prizes, okay? His brother is literally dying of cancer. And so he asked us to remember them in our prayers this morning as we pray. And so I just want to lead us in a time of prayer. Again, thank you for being here this morning. If you're visiting with us, thank you for coming. We know you could have gone elsewhere, and we appreciate you coming and worshiping with us today. We really do mean that. And Doug, again, I know that. But thank you again, Doug, for the work that you do and for the great job, choir, that you have done.
Joe and all the tech and
We wouldn't have known. Listen, we don't notice Joe. We don't notice Joe till he messes up, okay? So if he messes up, we'll notice him, right? And so we didn't even notice Joe was here today. So thank you guys. And so let me pray if I can, and then we have a reprise. So we ask you to enjoy the last song that our choir does today. But let me lead us in a time of prayer. Lord, I do pray for Lisa today. I pray, dear God, that you would give her a peace, as the scripture says, that passes all human understanding. God, we pray that you would guide the doctors as they do the surgery. We pray, Lord, that you would be honored and magnified even through the surgery. And God, we pray for complete healing of her body from the cancer. Lord, cancer is such a painful and awful thing. And God, we just pray that you would free your children from this awful disease. Yes. God, I do pray today for Di's family and Frank's family, that you would be with them. And Lord, that you would just be with his brother. I believe it's David, as he goes through this time of leaving this life and going into eternity. And God, I thank you that the grave is not the end. But we thank you, Lord, because of your resurrection, that we will be resurrected with you. And God, we thank you for eternal life. Lord, we pray that even through this death, even through this time of suffering, that, Lord, that this family will see Jesus. We love you and we praise you. We thank you for the message that we've heard today. So give us this week, Lord, to touch somebody's life with the love of Jesus. In the name of my Savior, I pray. Amen. Brother Doug.
And the church said,
Amen.
The tomb is indeed empty, and what was old is new again. What was lost has been redeemed. But justice demanded grace forgave. We have a reason to celebrate. We are forgiven and free. Let all the world sing that Jesus is risen.
Praise team people, if they with us, please come up for a photo.
I got my baby.